future generations would like to see me just standing up there writing. Okay, I want to talk about three realities of man towards God, and this is going to incorporate what we talked about last class, which would be class number one. And I want to use the basic picture of the tabernacle in its three different compartments. And I know this isn't, it's almost to scale, but it's not. But I'm sure it's pretty close because I'm sure the Holy Spirit led me in doing that. Okay. All right, so the basic layout here is that the larger rectangle on the inside of it is the outer court. The smaller rectangle is divided into the holy place and the holy of holies. And most of you know the layout and whatever. But anyway, the Israelites were camped around this whole thing. And the way that they were laid out, if you could see it from above, like a plane flying over, it'd be the shape of a cross. That's how they were laid out. It was all laid out. This was the center and the heart of the camp. And so there is these basically three relationships, what I call three realities of man towards God. And the first one is the camp and the outer court. And I know this is, I've never heard anybody share it like this, and so like anything I share, you don't have to listen to it. Just try to listen to God if he has anything to say in it. But the camp and the outer court had one main thing that was identifiable about it, and that was the sun could shine on it, okay? The Holy of Holies and the holy place was covered, but the sun could shine on that, and while it shone on that, depending on where the sun was, there were shadows all about. And so we're gonna tie this to what we were sharing before, and one thing you have to remember too is that the shadows that they fell not just outside the camp, but in the outer court. And I relate this area to the people of God, okay? People of God. Okay, and here's why I include the outer court in that, because over here's the door, and there's a door right here. There's not a door. None of this is a real door. It's actually all veiled. This is a veil, but it's an entrance. That's a better word. This is an entrance through veil, and this was a veil also into the Holy of Holies. And there was the brazen altar right as you came into the front door, and that's where sacrifices could be offered and stuff. And so you could come just as one of the people of God, and you could come and, you know, give your offering, and it could be killed right there for you and stuff like this. And, of course, here's the laver, and maybe I'll redraw this here in a minute so you can see all the furniture. But right now, I want to see the sections and the realities of these things in relationship to God and how we end up relating to him. In other words, this might apply to us today, and we might be in one of these sections based on how we relate to God. So that relates to that. The inner thing here has three main, the holy place has three main parts in there, and that's the golden candlestick, seven-branch golden candlestick, the table of showbread, and the altar of incense. And all three of those objects are meant to be manifestations of what God is like. Manifestations of what the being behind the veil is like. Manifestations. They're not shadows. They're not in the sun in that sense to be able to cast a shadow. And part of the whole thing of this class right here is that we want to get into the different parts. We want to get into, you know, those three objects in the holy place, the Ark of the Covenant, those things that are in the outer court. So the people of God are out here. And the being of God is in the Holy of Holies. And then place to really try to grasp him without seeing him directly is here in the area of manifestation. So outer court is and camp is shadows. Holy place is manifestation. And Holy of Holies is the being of God. All right. And that should be a progression also. That's not necessarily because people tend to camp at certain places and not move on. See, they'll just camp there and stay there. All right, so the people of God are the people of God. They are surrounding this camp. They are within the camp, surrounding the tabernacle. They are those who love God. They are those who serve God in the things that they do. But they serve God primarily in relationship to what they're doing in their daily lives. And that's how they serve God. Okay. to me... the outer court can also be a place where we are ministering according to the shadows of God. It is something that is came down from the mount. It is us, or at least someone, having seen the being of God and made something according to that pattern. But we are, how did it say that in... Hebrews chapter 8, who serve the shadow. They serve the shadow. They're not serving God. They're serving the shadow. And I think that there are a lot of ministers that fall in that category. I think that there are a lot of, you know, I mean, I don't know how many real true apostles we have nowadays, but apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. Of course, we call that the fivefold ministry, and I've told you before that the pastor teacher is, in the Greek, it is one person. Anybody remember that? Check it out. Anyway, so it would actually be a fourfold ministry. I mean, if you're going to be accurate to what it's saying, it's the fourfold ministry. It's not, that's not a separate thing. but there is a change as a person is progressing when they come into the outer court and they begin to make their way further along into that progression. And that is that they may change from just being, for example, let's just say that a priest, you know, at this time they had no place for a priest to live within the tabernacle. Nobody spent the night in there. Okay, except Joshua. He's the only one. And that was because of his great hunger for the Lord. But there was no facilities there for that. There were in the temple, but not in the tabernacle. So that priest would go home, and when he went home, while he was at home with his family or whatever, he was just one of the people of God. But as, and I'm going to say it like this, but as he proceeded, especially deeper in, more and more and more, he began to be a priest. All right. Now, I know some of you have maybe had Catholic backgrounds. We're not talking about that kind of priest. The scriptures, you know, I've had people say, well, all of us are priests, and they were trying to do, you know, pastoral things. I'm going, yeah, but we're not all pastors, you know. Are all pastors? I think that's exactly Paul's words. Are all this or all that? No. But we all are supposed to be priests. And I think that very little is really known about it. So most people just assume they're a priest because the Bible says they're a priest. But you see, if you looked, remember the thing I drew with the triangle. If you look, you can't know what a priest is by looking at anything in America, if you will. You have to go to the shadow. You remember? We talked about that. And if you go there, and remember, we talked about it with Jesus. If Jesus is hanging on the cross and we know nothing of the shadow, we know nothing of the old covenant, we know nothing of that, there is no explanation there. The disciples didn't have it. Mary, the mother of Jesus, didn't have it. Jesus didn't explain it to everybody. He didn't say, this is the fulfillment of, you know, the old covenant. You would have to know that and then know the shadow and then equate this with this is the actual Day of Atonement or this is the actual Passover or this is the actual real offering of the Lamb that the shadow talked about. This is. And so, so it is my opinion, and my opinion isn't worth much, and you shouldn't take that into too much credit. But my opinion is that I see very little activity of Christians as priests. I see, and I'm not confining that to this room, okay? I'm saying generally, and I travel a lot, so I'm talking about what I see. And I see very little true activity that a New Testament priest that is fulfilling the shadow that was in the mount, I see very little activity of that. And that most people, when they say they're a priest, you know, part of it is they think that makes them automatically a minister of the gospel, and it doesn't. And it is one of the primary emphasis in the New Testament and is full in the Old Testament so that we may from the shadow derive what the being that we call God, the being, desires of us. Okay, here's the problem. We have learned what that being, we don't even have to call him a being. We've learned what Jesus requires of us, and we've learned that from church services and books and stuff. And most of it is not priestly work. It's not priestly at all. It is not fulfilling the priesthood. It is not fulfilling the thing God had in mind when he said, you will be a kingdom of priests. It is just people being Christian. It is. It's just, that's primarily what I see anyway. And like I said, I already told you, don't, you know, go ahead and discount anything I say. It doesn't matter or mean anything. But just on the off chance that maybe it really was from God, it might be good to at least pray about it and say, Lord, is it possible that I could have missed a huge portion of the way I'm supposed to be functioning before you? And, you know, our hearts should be tender at all times, not based on a move of God. Do we have to have a move of God to be tender towards the Spirit of God who may want to, you know? But if we're not, because we're just people of God, we're in the camp, we are of God. But like I said, something, you know, for lack of a better word, something magical starts happening as this guy that's living out here with his family and everything comes in to start being a priest. Everything is being swallowed up around him now of fulfillment of what God wanted. Okay. Do you understand what I mean? This is all swallowing him up.
Yes.
It is, he's not in charge. He's not good at what he does. He does what God wants him to do in the spirit that God wants him to do it in. It's not about, well, I'm a priest, I'm a big shot. It is that you enter in here, and the picture that I saw, as I said, a whole lot of this was shared to me in my sleep. The picture that I saw was, so here is the, at the edge of the rug here is the entrance into the tabernacle, and as this man wakes up and, you know, he has his coffee and he rubs his kid's head and sends him off to Torah class. He looks regular or whatever as far as his facial features and all this, but as he steps through that door and proceeds into the things that are of God, that came from God's heart and are a picture of the being. It was like I saw regular clothes falling off of him and priestly garments coming upon him. I saw something in his step. I saw a heart change. I saw that there was that there was just something about him, because now he was the priest of God. And he's about to enter in to the things that God set up and said, this is what I want you to do forever. You go, what do you mean? Yeah, I want this morning and evening sacrifice perpetual. I want the candlestick changed every morning. I want the showbread changed out every Sabbath and fresh bread put there. I want the incense burning. I want all of this, and I want it to be perpetual. Okay. So we go, okay, well, I'm a Christian when I go to church. I feel real spiritual because I'm a Christian, because it just misses the mark. It does. It just misses the mark of the heart of God. But you see, here's the way we look at it. Okay, well, if I'd have been Moses, I'd be more attentive to this stuff. Okay. So, Aaron, who was made the high priest, had four sons. And two of them right off the bat brought in strange fire. You say, well, what is that? And I won't do it. Yeah, you might already be doing it, And God killed them right off. Because they're outside of life. They're already dead. They're outside of life. They don't know what life is. They don't know what functioning in this spirit is. They don't know, they don't have a heart for this being, this one who, from whom the pattern came by, but he wasn't a pattern. He was the real, and this is the pattern, and he hasn't seen that being. And so he just does the best he can. Can you imagine after years and years and years and nobody's really seeing the true being from the pattern in the mount, they saw him, that nobody saw that. And after a while, they're just doing stuff. I mean, maybe it gets down to the point where it's like Eli's priesthood. Remember Eli the priest and his sons and the stuff they were pulling. And it was all seemed acceptable and, people didn't like it, but, they were used to it. You get used to things. You get used to it. And I don't even mean, and this is really my point, isn't the bad things that the sons of Eli did. That's not my point. My point is anything that is no longer coming from being. It's just a shadow that we've, you know, that we've grasped hold of, because we could grasp a shadow in the sense of understanding that, or we could see Jesus's manifestations. We assume from Jesus's healing and miracles like that and stuff, we assume that those are demonstrations of God and of God's power and of God's mind. He wants everybody healed. That this is strictly to use power that y'all don't have to make sure that, you know, you get healed, and healing is the goal. And not see, you know, for example, the Holy Spirit just brings to my mind not a healing miracle, but Jesus sees the multitudes as a sheep without a shepherd. And like any good priest, you know, he immediately thinks of the showbread. Remember, David ate of the showbread when he had no strength, and his men were worn out, and David literally walked into the holy place, not the holy place, got the 12 loaves, fed his men on that. That's like a priest. That's like a priest. Hallelujah. Jesus saw him as that, and he got whatever bread he could get, and he broke it and had communion. But in truth, he didn't have communion, because they didn't know what it was or what it meant. And maybe David's men didn't know what it was and what it meant. Maybe David didn't know. But something was going on with David, because Jesus brings up that story. Yes. And he says and then Hebrews brings it up. You know? In a certain sense of the showbread, and the eating of the showbread. And so there is this easy pattern, and it's called cruise control. And we're not only all susceptible to it. I mean, what if I could just wave my hands like this and God would reveal every person where you're at spiritually and how much technology you got running your car? Brakes, it'll brake for you, it'll drive, it'll slow down, it won't change lanes because it knows that da 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 da. You do realize this technology is just on the verge now. Okay, good. I mean, it's just about here. And, you know, we don't just have it on cruise control of our speed, but of so many other things. And I could just do that, and he'd show you. And you would look and go, my God, I have so much where I'm no longer using my heart. And I'm no longer, and my eyes are more trained to see where others are missing it than myself. Yes. You know, it's like I've been training for years. You know, I got this one down. That's wrong. You know, you got a lot going for you there, but this thing's wrong right there, okay? Just see all this stuff instead of seeing Jesus. And that, there we go back. We always will hearken back to Hebrews. You have to. And it says in chapter 11, you know, talks about the heroes of faith and that this and that and all this, all these different stories. And then at the end of it, he doesn't say, so get up and do what these guys did. He doesn't say that. It begins the next chapter after he's described all that with these words. But we see Jesus. I mean, it's see Jesus. That's what it says. Consider him. And that is all through Hebrews, isn't it? But we see Jesus up in chapter, 2? And consider him. It's always him. It's always going back to the being. We say it's always going back to Jesus because it's always about Jesus. But it's always going back to the being of, it could have gone to Christianity. It could have gone to the Savior. But so much of it is getting into, when it gets into all the priesthood and everything. This is a priesthood after the order of Melchizedek. Jesus is a priest after the order of Melchizedek. And we go, well, okay, I don't have a clue of what that means. Well, try looking at the showbread long enough. Try seeing that and then seeing the being from which that manifestation came. But we grab the manifestation. Healing. Jesus has compassion, so he heals somebody. And that might be that lamb spirit that's working in him. That you know, and that's why he doesn't go, you're healed, now follow me. He doesn't do that. He says, you're healed, don't tell anybody. But when we get healed or see someone healed, we tell everybody. Because it's about healing. It's not about the being and the thing that works in him that makes it reflect back in the book of Revelation like a lamb, or makes it reflect back in the New Testament as Jesus slain on a cross, or makes it reflect back on an altar where lambs are slain one after the other, after the other, after the other, after the other, again and again and again and again. We never read through Romans and it says, for we are as sheep as the slaughter. We are daily killed. We're killed all the day long. And we never look at that and say, that's the continual offerings going up. That's the real, because we have the real in us. And this is a sweet savor of him, not me, not us. And I'm living in this. And the scriptures are becoming, the New Testament is becoming being. Amen. Going to the one in the mount. You understand what I'm saying? Going to the one in the mount. It's always pointing back to, because that's real. That's right. That's where life is. That's the logos of life. The word, the logos. And so, you know, we read, here's the deal. I mean, I will never have enough time ever in the rest of my life. I don't have that much years left in my life on this planet. And you think, well, he must be thinking he's going soon. If I had 100 more years, I could never express all of the things I think that the Spirit of God continually shows me and takes a scripture. And remember, you remember the triangle, right? Being is what was seen in the mount. You get special blue, but that ain't working so well. And then shadow was the Old Testament. And then manifestation. Manifest. And to see, and we talked about the inner relationship behind all of these, and yet this, the being, is what is the meaning of all that is created. The being is the fulfillment of all shadows. And so, I mean, I am constantly, constantly, constantly seeing New Testament scriptures that I know for a fact that most Christians don't see being in light of the shadow, and then we live it in the new covenant, like the one we just talked about. We are killed all the day long. We are as sheep for the slaughter. We never see that in light of, this is that being. This is the way this, he looks like a lamb in Revelation. He looks like a crucified Messiah in you know, the Gospels. But it's more than that, because those are manifestations. I can never fully explain what only the Holy Spirit can reveal of him that was and is to come. Alpha and Omega, beginning and end. First and the last. We go, well, he's real big to me too. Really? Really? Is that enough? Yeah, he's real big to me. Is he Alpha and Omega? I don't even know what that means. Is he first and the last? Well, he's first because he created us, and he's the last because he's on the throne when it's all over with. That's not being stuff. Being stuff. That's not being stuff. That's working it out on a timeline and seeing how it's not comprehending the being of God. And therefore, we can never be killed all the day long. We just Christian all day long. We just do our Christian thing to the glory of God. We walk around in his tabernacle, his body, and we violate constantly the very things that he set up that are based on him, and now they're based on us. We're like sleight of hand tricksters that can change the very things that emanated originally from his being that now we've got it, you know, it's about me. It's for me. And to take all of that away from him, wipe him out, don't even include him in the equation, and just draw a big long timeline. Well, there was old covenant, now there's new covenant, and that was the shadow, and this is the fulfillment instead of the manifestation. Yeah, it's the fulfillment, but it's only the fulfillment in manifestation, if you will. I mean, come on, Lord, Holy Spirit, stop. He's flooding me. You know, Jesus is sitting there. Last Supper. Disciples are all there. He takes bread. He breaks it. He says, "This is my body." Okay, so Peter goes, "Uh-uh. We're your body. That's just bread. We're your body." See, now I'm getting into the showbread. You know? But we can't figure it out. But Jesus isn't saying, "Guys, this is my body." He's going, "This is my body." But we know that bread, and that particular bread, wasn't his body. But he said, "This is my body." And then the next day, he's crucified, and his true body comes forth. Gosh, I'm so full of a good thing, but you know, in the holy place, there was the table of showbread that was over here, the seven branch candlestick that was over here, and the altar of incense was here, and there were 12 loaves on that table of showbread. And it was shown, it was set out, and it was on that table for 6 days, and nobody touched it. It was for show. It was being shown to God. God was viewing it, and they were supposed, the priest would pass by and supposed to contemplate that bread. What is this? What is he doing? What is this a manifestation of? What is this a reality of? And then on the Sabbath, the seventh day, they're supposed to sit down and eat what they've been thinking about and everything. So God, we think that God, in this big picture here of the camp, we think he's up here looking and he's going, "This is my body," the whole camp and all of this. "This is my body," and we're out there going, "Well, I'm his body, so I need to follow through with, you know, the things that the commandments and all the things that he wants." And our minds are all there, and our minds are all infected with us. And his eyes are on the 12 loaves of bread, show bread. It's laying there for him to see, for him to look at. He's not seeing the madness. And we continue to see the madness and do the madness and then ask him to bless the madness. And he sees differently. He's a different kind of being. He is so different. He's so different. And so they're all out there in the in the camp, and there's all stuff. Somebody's fighting with their neighbor, and they're all intense. You remember that? I mean, that, you know, they're all intense. And, well, you got too close to my tent, and da-da-da-da, and that's going on. Somebody's slipping their hand underneath the tent of somebody else and taking something for themselves, and somebody else is, you know, they're just being people, right? People of God, doesn't matter if they're, you know, same stuff happens. You, by the way, the Ten Commandments weren't for sinners. You know, don't steal or kill. That was for God's people. You know, we always go, well, those dirty sinners. You know, God's going, you know, I don't really like looking at you, but if I do, here's ten commandments on stone. As long as you're going to be that, this is it. Until this can be being written on the fleshly table of your heart. Oh, Holy Spirit. So the Holy of Holies, it can't be entered into. And I'm not just talking about that day once a year, da 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 da. I'm talking about this day. Now, come boldly, come enter in, right? Let's draw near. Anybody remember all that kind of stuff, you know? Okay. Well, he's got something in his mind, though, see? And it has to do with us. If we know the shadow a little bit, then the Holy Spirit can breathe on that. Then we can see the manifestation in the New Testament. Then he can breathe on that. And from these things, he can begin to formulate and then reveal the being of God that we have to name God or Jesus or whatever. And all of those hold us to little definitions. So that's why I just call it the being. Because you got no definition for that one. You don't have one. Well, you know, well, he's just a being. Yeah. That's the perfect place. You're a priest. You're contemplating what? The table that is showing the bread for 6 days, then eating it. You're contemplating the light from the golden candlestick. What a story there. What a story. What a story there. You're contemplating the altar of incense and the sweet incense that God wants. But it's time to grasp and then go in. You know, because you go in there, you're going to go in there where being is. And you're going to enter in by two things. You're going to enter in by death and unveiling. You say, well, where's the death? What do you mean I'm going to enter in by death? It's how the high priest got in there. It wasn't his death, but it was counted as his death. He took the lamb and he put it to death and he said, this is what I'm identified with. You know, this is what I'm identified with. And when the being in there sees this identification, I won't be killed personally for what I should be killed for. Because that being measures all things by Christ, but only because Christ is part of that being. I mean, I'm telling you, that's really what it is. We go, well, thank God for the Messiah, or, you know, the Christ, you know. But oh, I had a great translation. I wrote, what was it? Let's see, Paul said in 1 Corinthians 2:2, I'm determined not to know anything among you but Christ and Him crucified. And the Holy Spirit gave it to me like this. I'm determined not to know anything among you but Christ in crucified form. By the way, that's the Messiah sitting on the throne there in the book of Revelation, that Lamb. Christ, I'm determined not to know anything among you but Christ in crucified form. Because every other version of the Messiah, every other version of Christ, misses the mark of who the being is. And Paul got it. He got it. He got it. You know, remember, he was a remember, he was a Jew in the shadow beforehand. He knew it. He was a Pharisee, for God's sake. He had to memorize the Pentateuch, first five books of the Bible. He had to know it up and down. He probably partook in many different ways in the offerings and saw sheep, lamb after lamb after lamb after lamb after, you know, slaughtered. And one day he comes to it and he goes, you know what? This isn't about the guy that just walked around and healed and blessed and stuff like that. That, if I redefine the being of God from what he really is to what serves me, I've done the greatest perversion that could ever be reached. Ceremonial uncleanness, greater than any sin that you could do, greater than any breach you could do. That's what killed Nadab and Abihu. Ceremonial uncleanness, and because they did something that wasn't Christ. Christ who? Christ in crucified form. Because it had to do with that. You see that? It had to do with that. Most of the breaches that God had a hard time with, Eli's sons, all of that, you know, this Nadab and Abihu, most of the breaches that he had were in relationship to sacrifice. They didn't give him what he asked to have. You will be my people if you'll give me what I ask. And what he asks is Christ in crucified form in you, the hope of glory. That's what he desires. It is. And why? Why? Okay, because that's still just a manifestation. Christ in crucified form is a manifestation. It's not the full revelation of the being. And he said that. He said, when the kingdom is delivered up to me, I will deliver it up to God, and then God will be all and in all. Remember, Christ, now Christ is all and in all. Christ is, because he's the door. But eventually, it's going to go to the fullness of the being that he's part of. But he doesn't, let me tell you this. God chose, you can read in Colossians 1:18, maybe I should look it up real quick. We're almost, maybe I'll sleep tonight. Colossians 1, oh gosh, let's do start in verse 15. Okay, this crucified lamb, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, for by him were all things created that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or what? Dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him, and he is before all things, and by him all things consist, and he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. Okay, I got news for you. You might go, if you're thinking that's Jesus and that was you, you'd be thinking Jesus is going, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. I get it all. I am so special. This is all centered on me. But I'm going to tell you something. I'll just put it in this way. I'm going to tell you something I believe. And I give you the option not to believe it or not to check it out. I believe that that doesn't please Jesus at all. His whole life was spent glorifying the Father. I don't think that he's jumping up and down like we would. I don't think that he's moved in that way. I think his being is completely, completely different than ours. And that's one reason why we need Christ in crucified form formed in us. Because why? Because it's a different being. So his honor ultimately is back into the whole of the being. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit known to them in different forms, known as one. Yes. Known as one, not known as separate. I'm telling you, not known as separate. Because their whole identity is the them that is one. And it is this being that makes them one. They are one being. They are not three in that sense. They're only three to demonstrate one of the purest pictures of the being. Jesus declares the Father. The Holy Spirit declares Jesus. It's all this constant give and take. Nobody taking it to him. Not only the Holy Spirit reveals Jesus, the Holy Spirit won't speak of himself. Jesus going, you know, I can't remember the exact wordings, and I think this is in John 5, but Jesus says something like, well, the works I do are not mine, but they're the Father's. And they got into a bigger rage now because not only had he done something on the Sabbath, but he made himself equal with God. It's not in him to make himself equal with God. The very thing in Philippians 2 says he did not think being like God was something to be grasped after, fought over, wanted more than to be self-giving and dying for people down here. That's the conclusion of Philippians 2, 5 through 8. That he looked at the options. And one option was to keep your godhood and therefore nobody will ever hurt you, and keep your power and you can get back at those who mistreat you, and keep whatever, you can keep all this godly good stuff. And he thought, you know, if I have a choice between that and going down here and just being crucified and dying for them so that they might have life, that my murderers could have life, I think I'll choose this. I'll choose this. Death. I'll choose. That's my being. That's easy. See, that's not easy for us. And that's why we have such a hard time. Oh, don't preach that, Randy. That always hurts my feelings. Or, you know, something. You know, I can't do that. Or we have those little things. Anybody know what I'm talking about? There's, you know, you hit a certain nerve and it goes, I don't want to hear that, you know. I'm not ready to give that up, me. and it's hard because we know stuff about the being, reduced it down to manifestations and calling it the Messiah or the Savior. But before the world was, Jesus wasn't a Jew. You say, well, he really blessed the Jewish people by coming down as a Jew. Okay, but he didn't come down to be Jewish. Now, he raised up people that says there's neither. He didn't say there's Jews and there's Greeks and there's bond and free and we're all one. He said there's neither Neither of those. None of that. Christ is all and in all. Okay. Well, that was quoted in Colossians, which was not a Jewish community. And he's talking to Gentiles that Messiah crucified is supposed to be living in you. What is that song? Take now your holy throne. Blah, 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 blah. Folks, if he doesn't have us, he's got nothing. He's got a bunch of wildcats for kingdomites, you know. His kingdom, you know, well, at least I'm in charge. Hey, stop that. Quit that. Don't do that. Hey, stop. Can you, you know, that's, I can't wait till he comes and sets up his rule on him. If he does, you're going to spend the rest of your life in jail because you're a rebel to his being. I can't wait for it. You know, you remember what the prophet says. You know, so you're looking forward to the day of the Lord. Huh? He says, you shouldn't be doing that. This is going to be a day of what? Agony and death and fire and burning. And, you know, and he's just talking about the effect, you know, like John the Baptist said in a polite way. Well, when he comes, the crooked will be jerked straight and the high will be brought down and the low will come. And all that speaks of his being. What's high can't be high, not in his kingdom. What's low can't remain low, see? Jesus was low. He's still low. He's a lamb on the throne, but God exalted him. What did he put on the throne? He didn't put a guy with crowns and muscles and holding a sword like this and going, you know, I am the king. I have conquered. He put a slain, slaughtered little lamb on that throne. I exalt that. The minute he turns to be some great conqueror, back down you go. That's being. That's being. You know, be ye holy, for I am holy. Okay, I'll try. I didn't say try. I said be, and you're doing. There's so many scriptures, you know, that we might be to the praise of his glory. Yes, I will praise his glory. I didn't ask you to praise. Sit down. I asked you to be that. Will you do that in that spirit? You'll exalt him well beyond any praise and worship service you can imagine if his being is at work in you. But if not, your praise and worship depends on how well you slept the night before. It depends on the mood that you're in. It depends on if anything good happened recently or anything bad happened recently, or you know what I mean? Because it's all, you know, we go, oh, I want the Lord to inhabit my praises. How about you let him inhabit you? I mean, we pull these little scriptures out and go, you know, this is, you know, the whole New Testament's talking about Christ in you, formed in you. We go, hey, inhabit my praises. God, I can't tell you this stuff. I can't, and I'll tell you what, pray for me, because the Holy Spirit is driving me crazy with this stuff. It's just like swirling and then pictures of how it plays out, like the priest just magically, not magic, but magically turns into this priest that serves God and not himself or his family and all this other stuff, you know, within the confines of this being. Because we'd say then the confines of this kingdom. Oh, it's the king. It's the king.
That's it. Yes.
But the king is a, king of kings is a slaughtered lamb. Revelation 17. So it's like, what? See, and the bad thing, if you start really getting into this, the scriptures will just be like little grasshoppers jumping out at you. whoa, you can't even hold it all in. You know, it's like, because it testifies of him. Jesus said, search the scriptures, they are they which testify of me. We go, yeah, I saw something back in 2007. You know, I mean, every day, every moment. But this book cannot come alive until you start seeing the being of the book. Because don't you think this book's always going to be around in heaven, right? You know, the only book I'm sure of that's going to last is the Lamb's Book of Life. Lamb's Book of Lamb Life. See, and if this doesn't get us to that, we ain't going to be written there. You say, Randy, you're scaring me now. I don't even know what to say. I don't know what to say that. I am not trying to scare you. All right, let's pray. Father, thank you for your Son, who is your express image, the express image of your person. The greatest manifestation of who you are, but still just a manifestation. Just like the altar could be seen by even people of God in the camp as the priest killed their lamb. If he could stand at that door and just watch the process, there's one thing for sure. If that was not a brazen altar, but a crucified son, it still doesn't bring us into the fullness of your being until we see past what we see based upon our perceptions, needs, freakouts, and all the things that consume us. God, you are a consuming fire, and we all get afraid of that. But may it burn up everything that is not Christ crucified in us. May it consume it away in a negative way. And then on the other hand, may it consume as if it was the greatest meal you ever had, the lamb that gave himself and is a sweet savor offering unto you. And may it fill you and satisfy you. Father, I ask you to continue to speak and to move by your Spirit. And I pray that our gatherings next week and every time we will be more ready, more in tune, more that it wouldn't be just water poured over a rock, but it'll be water poured into a sponge and held and kept, and begin to identify us as a sponge that is full, not a dried up sponge or a rock that can hold no water. We ask it for your glory and not for our own. We pray not based on us being in the center and what we want. We know that these are the things you want of us. And so where you guide, you will provide. Continue to open our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're just